a better place waiting for me in heaven. Every tear will be wiped away, every sorrow and sin erased. We'll dance on seas of amazing grace in heaven. In heaven, I'm going home where the streets are golden, every chain is.
You to share. Amen. It's amazing. I want you to share. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Pastor Nadia. Praise the Lord. It's true, I'm shy, but I can speak. So yesterday we went out to some numbers, mm-hmm. and he sent out some invitation for people that need food. So they came out in numbers. They even got there before us. We got there like 9:20 something, and the appointment was 10 to 11. So we reached out to those ones. And then in Forest Lawn, it really touched me. I was there with Minister Diana.
Okay, first of all, what did you guys go
do? Okay, we packed food boxes. I forgot that. So we pack food boxes. We put groceries, canned food, even chicken. And things like that. Snacks for kids. And then Christmas cards handwritten by Heidi and myself. So we prepared the boxes and put a ribbon, you know, we decor so that it meant that we meant it. Like, so it's not just, we didn't just buy boxes and put stuff in it. So we did it like we meant it. And we prayed about it. Amen. And it happened. And in Forest Lawn, we got so many testimonies. Oh, I remember you last year. So because we started it last year. And then somebody mentioned something that really touched me. He said, oh, I was going to go to the food bank, and my car broke down, and then you guys came to give me food. You know? Yeah. Kinds of people, like Prophetess Mada mentioned. Yeah, we saw all those people yesterday. And I have a friend. She's actually a Muslim. She gave me money, and she brought her two sons with me, with other people. Amen. Even on the road, when we were buying groceries, we met one woman. She said, oh, my daughter would use this. So we went to her daughter's house, a new mom. We did all, I don't know how to say all this. We have many testimonies about yesterday. So, and now I am ready for Christmas, because if I don't do that, I can't do Christmas that I have.
Amen.
And I'm... And I want to thank CrossPointe, because the CrossPointe really supported me. This woman.
Go for it.
Pastor Nadia, Pastor Jenny, she is my biggest fan. sometimes when I don't want to do something and I talk to Pastor Jane, I said, I'm telling you so that I would do it. She said, oh, you're doing it now that you told me. So she she's like that. And my husband, yeah, 20, we had no plan, nothing. And then in November, November 5th, 6th, we didn't know we would do this. And then we went to admitting. Something happened in admitting, and I came back. On that day, I talked to Pastor Jenny. I said, something happened in admitting, and I think I have to do this thing because it's needed. Before we went to admitting, Pastor Shaka talked to me. He said, that thing we did last year, are we doing it? I was like, oh, my goodness. They said, he's in. I said, oh, my goodness. So people are really ready
to talk. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Can we thank God for this woman? She's representing Christ and CrossPointe with her team in our community. God bless you. Hallelujah. You put CrossPointe cards, of course. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So I was in Australia, and then I was in a church, and I saw that they had a Christmas gift giving. Usually we do it in the secret, and we go, we minister to people. But I send a message to. So we're going to have a gift giving service on a Sunday where we're going to bring our boxes. We'll let you know what to put in. And then we're just going to go into the community and be a blessing. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you guys with me? So we thank God for BC, because now it's going to go viral, amen, in the whole CrossPointe to be a blessing. I love what she said. She said, there's no way I can celebrate Christmas unless I give to somebody else who is in need first. Isn't that wonderful? That's the spirit of Christmas. Praise the Lord. Amen. So I'm going to ask Bethia to come up here. She will be ministering to us. Today is her last day in this church. Praise the Lord. We're going to be strong because we want her to preach. She's been, yes, I want. So she's been here with us for 11 years. And everyone who enters this church, the first person she sees, they see is Bethia standing here ministering to us day in and day out. She's never stopped ministering to us in every possible way. And it is a privilege for us to send her off. Amen. And she's going to minister to us her last day here. She's going to Nova Scotia. Praise the Lord. Well, however, whatever the wind takes you, Bethia, we just got to follow it. Amen. But before she ministers, Apostle said we're going to take an offering for her to send her off. Amen. If this woman has been a blessing to you, I want you to let it be thank you gift. Let it be something that she has done for you. Amen. We're going to hear when Bernard came. She was leading then. And then she told Apostle, I said, you know what? I need to let Bernard lead because he's let somebody else take over because they see that it's going to be profitable for the church. It wasn't about her. It was about for the work of God. You know, Bethia, I can never forget that. And let's give her. And please write a note to thank you inside that envelope form. Amen. Praise the Lord. And then she will minister the word of God to us. She's a woman who has a good testimony that we can testify. Who has stood beside us, stood by us. Her unending prayers for us, for Amadou, your passion for Amadou, Bethia, God bless you. We're going to do this. When you're done, you can bring your envelope up here. Okay, we can get the keyboard playing a little bit while we are waiting. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's be a blessing, Church of God. Thank you, Lord. Preach. Hallelujah, hallelujah. While you're giving, I'd like to just get to send my deepest condolences to the Nigerian community. You've lost a beautiful ring for you guys, for God to give you strength. I didn't know her, but may God give you comfort wherever you are, especially to Dayo. God bless you, Dayo, wherever you are. Hallelujah. Do you want to sing this song while we are waiting?
So he'd stay there. Good morning, CrossPointe. Are we still morning? Yes, we are. Good morning, CrossPointe. It's been a pleasure seeing your faces for the past 11 years. You have aged gracefully. You know I owe you one. you've heard my name is Bethia. I've been a member of this house for the past 11 years. Pardon me if I seem a little bit scatterbrained. It's just emotional. I wear my heart on my sleeves. I didn't know how long I was gonna stay when I came to Calgary. I moved from Hamilton, Ontario. 2008, and around that time, you know, I shared a little bit, you know, the past time I was up here, that I had found a job in Hamilton, and I was working in a personal injury law firm, and it was a good job. It was the first stable job that I'd had. You know, the hours were crazy, but I was not complaining, because it was one day I was in the office, I think it was over the lunch hour, I heard a voice. I was just looking out of my window, and I heard a voice say that I was going to die. I thought I was gonna die, but clearly it wasn't about death. And I ended up, and things were like dry as a bone. When you know, like, when you open your wallet and all that's flying out is butterflies, things were that dry. And so we got to, that morning I woke up, because everyone, we had told the landlord that we're moving out. It was my sister and myself. We told the landlord that we're moving out, told my pastor that I'm leaving, packed up everything, but I hadn't bought the ticket. But we knew we were going. And that one morning I woke up, a day that I said I'm going, and the tickets were on sale. They were $99 one way to Edmonton. I've never seen them that low. Well, with the addition of Swoop and all this other low-cost airlines now, you might get it that low. But at the time, it was just WestJet, and it was $99 one way. We booked to call from the payphone to call my aunt to come and pick us up. When I say it was that dry, you had to count your coins so that you're not spending excessively. And so we landed in Edmonton, and the first thing I tell my sister, like, this is how crazy, you know, I am. The sense of humor just never dies out. I said, we have landed in Mogadishu. For those who don't know where Mogadishu is the capital city of Somalia. And if you've been to Edmonton, there's a lot of Somalians there. She picked us up. We go and stay with her for a little bit. And before I moved to Edmonton, I had come there probably a few months prior just to survey the land. I didn't like it, but I sensed that it was time for me to go anyway. So I moved to Edmonton, and on that previous visit, I'd gone to all this agency for you. So I did. I did that. And the most interesting thing was that after all that networking, after all those things, none of those things panned out. And I began to question whether I had heard wrong. It was 3 months, 3 months of joblessness, just waiting. But my sister, who was unsure and uncertain about making this move, she got so many interviews. Like she was going back and forth to different cities in Alberta that I'd never heard of before. I remember because my pastor asked me in Hamilton, have you prayed? I said, I'll be honest, I haven't prayed much, but I know I have to go. Because if I stay, I will die. And I didn't know what that meant. It was not a physical kind of dying. But there is the times and seasons where we must up and go. And I love, I said, it's true. It's true, he'll mess up your life. I lived in Edmonton for 3 months. I was miserable because I didn't like Edmonton, but it was the most amazing time I had with God. Because it was a moment just to reconnect. It was no fluff, nothing. And my aunt would come and tell us, you know, you guys should go and apply. Don't just, you know, stay here and apply from the internet. Go out and apply. Eventually, I got a job in Calgary, moved out to Calgary. The interesting thing about that job is that I applied online the same way I'd applied for multiple other jobs when I graduated from university. Sorry, this sounds like there's something in the... It's okay. Do you mind if I switch out the mics? I can hear some... So in that job, I applied online and got the job. Got the first interview and they said it went well. It was with an agency. And then they told me that we're going to contact you from the and call you in for an interview. So they asked me, when is a good day for you? Sleep, eat, wake up, pray. But I woke up and I told them 2:00. And that day I woke up, I dressed as though the interview, I was going in person. It was a phone interview. But I dressed up, sat by the phone, and waited. Then they said, okay, we're going to, you know, the interview has gone well. We're going to send. So I hopped on a bus, Greyhound, came to Calgary. And as I drove in, we were on the Greyhound, just as you exit onto Memorial, just where you can see them to tell me that we'll get back to you. I want this job today. So we came in. I went in for the interview. And let me share some of the inner thoughts for those of you that are deep in your thoughts. I was worried that I was not going to get the job because, one, when I came into Calgary, I didn't see many black people. As I was walking downtown, I didn't see many black people. And then, number two, my hair was conservative for that. Because I'd come from Ontario, you know, it's a little bit more liberal in that sense. And I went in for the interview. And the attorney that was interviewing me, she had the real deal. I just had extensions. She had the real dreadlocks. And she had also just... Anyway, that's just kind of the journey in Calgary. A few months ago, I was in my house. And I heard a voice similar to one I heard. 11 years back, and it said, you won't be here for long. And I didn't understand what that meant. I just thought it was pertaining to the house, because I was inside my house. I thought, that's all it means. I won't stay in this house. And while I was there, I had applied for an opportunity with a business. While I was there, the manager of the company called me, and we talked about the position I'd applied for, and he said, you know, it's not a good fit, but if you're interested, we're looking to start this there in Halifax. So I said, I had to go, and this was where I had to be. I've never been in Halifax before. That was my first time going there. And as I came back, then began the wrestling. The wrestling with God. Why didn't you send me to a place more glamorous? I would have much liked to go back to Toronto. I'm just going to flow. There is the times and season when God calls us, and the call of God never comes at an opportune time. It never comes at an opportune time. It's always the time when it's inconvenient. I was settled. I have elsewhere. When I came to move to Calgary, Pastor Emmy, she's the one who picked me up from the Greyhound stop. And I came and I stayed with them for a little bit. And I decided to follow with them to their church because they were associate pastors. And I didn't feel it right that I'm living with them, but I let them go to a different church, then I go to a different church. So I just followed along. And I came along with them. And as I sat at what he called Good Earth downtown, and we just spoke heart to heart. Heart to heart. And let me just put it out there. The reason why I contacted Apostle to, you know, no, was not to present him my resume. This is all I've done, Pastor. But was because I knew I needed to be accountable to someone. And I knew that if I put my face in front of this person, he's going to call me out when I veer off. He didn't know me from anywhere. But there's a when you interact with somebody person to person, you become unforgettable as opposed to just a number in the crowd. I want to share a little bit about, and I've shared this before, but maybe taking a different angle of it. This is from the book of 1 Kings in 17. This is the widow. I didn't go much in depth. But 1 Kings chapter 17, from verse 7. We'll go from verse 7 to 11. Or maybe 12. I'm just going to read that from the NIV. Yeah. Some time later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him. Go at once. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar? Send me, please, a piece of bread. Keep going. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself. And might touch briefly on what it means that the call of God comes at inconvenient times. The call of God, or meaning the purpose and the mandate for which we're called. But here he is now, God sends him to a widow. Now, if you know widows, they're disadvantaged for the most part. Disadvantaged, and life has had a go at them. But this is who God chooses to send Elijah to. Go to the widow, Zarephath. And the Bible says that God says, I have instructed the widow to supply for you. I ask this question because of the following interaction that we have with Elijah. It's like he appears, he says, give me water. That's the lowest common denominator that I can do. You're not asking much of me. But then he ups the ante, and now he's asking for bread, and I don't have enough even for me and my son. That was an inconvenient time, and not even the right person for him to go to. Because if you're going to be sending me, number one, I've come from a place of the and I'm saying this because a lot of the times when God calls us, it baffles your mind. It doesn't make sense. And you hear this in a dialogue. I'm just going to eat. I only have this little for me and my son to eat and die. But God said at the beginning, I have instructed the widow to provide for you. So when did the instructions come? The instructions unfold at a time. They unfold in your saying yes to the one thing. Okay, I'm going to go and get the water. Then the next set of instructions shows up. You don't have time to prepare for the call of sending to Montreal to start a church. It's never that clear cut. You will know it, but it doesn't always line up. Because I've instructed the widow to supply to you, but here she is still battling. She had to wrestle with something. So simply because the call of God has come or the promise of God has come does not mean you won't have to wrestle with something. And this is what, the title of this was God's Call and Man's Response. Because our response warrants an action. And sometimes the first action is easy enough. Because it allows you to build, ask more of me, then I also begin to question. And this is what the call does. I've explained or shared with you how I moved to Edmonton, and I was sitting there in the basement of my auntie's house for 3 months, knowing that I'm the one who heard from God that I should go. But there's nothing telling me what I should be doing here. And you question. Don't want you to neglect that part of your journey. Is it a journey? Simply because the call has come does not mean it ends there. The call is gain courage. You build faith for the next step. So in her saying yes to go for walk, then comes the next ask. And you hear her in a dialogue. And she actually articulates it to Elijah and say, this is all I have. This is all I have. But she goes ahead and does it. When God calls us, sometimes the entry point is easy enough. Who wants to receive Jesus? All it takes to raise your hand, say this prayer after me. Jesus. And a lot of the times you haven't fully processed what it means. Actually, you don't know what it fully means to haven't given your life to Jesus. That first step is always the lowest one. And then begin the other demands, the process of you being saying yes to the call. Because the first one can easily weed a lot of people out. But once you say yes, then it begins to build faith. May the ask. She goes ahead and does what God has asked her to do through the servant. And it goes on that her food never ran out. Saying yes will cost you something. It will require something of you, something uncomfortable, something perhaps that you're not. I also want to juxtapose that with a story of Paul. I love also the book of Acts and just reading about the Acts of the Apostles. So we'll go to Acts chapter 20 and verse, 17. We'll start from 21. Acts 20 from 21. It said, I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in the Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I know only that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying the gospel of God's grace. The call, if I may use this, party in this issue, in this topic. It's the one sending the message that's more important. Not me, Paul, who has to go to another land to share. It is God who's sending the message. That is the most important party in it all. And his authority, the messenger, you're only conveying a message. But the one that has sent you with the message is the one that gives your message weight. If I come and say, I'm declaring war on your country, it's me. Exactly that same reaction. You will laugh because what army do I have behind me? What arsenal of weapons do you? Then that in the messenger alone, once he brings the message, you begin to tremble. Because you know the sender of the message carries enough weight to make it happen. And that's the same thing with Paul being sent to all these lands. He was warned that what awaits you there is hardship, prison. I'm interested in Christianity. I'm committed in my faith. Because commitment will carry you, will propel you through those dry seasons when you're questioning, God, did I hear from you? So that makes the demarcation is when we have made that commitment that I count my life worth nothing but to finish the race, but to do what God has called me to do. And so in that sense, we have that's more important than you. And number three, the weight of the message is bound in the one who sent it. And then in you going, your yes opens doors for everything else. The minute you say yes, everything in your life is easy game. Because you can't say, God, you can only use this, but the rest is for me. You may not have intended it when you first said yes. But this is, I love that's why we're in the kingdom. You to Montreal, you fly, you go there. But in you going there, it opens up all the other areas of your life to be used as ministry, to be used as a point of contact. Now, Paul, everything that he was a Jew, he was a Roman citizen, he was a learned individual, he was a former Pharisee, and he's an ex-con. Everything was easy game for God to use. And that's why Paul could say, of all sinners of whom I am the worst, yet God chose me to deliver worthy. But there is Paul who has committed the ultimate, who has been persecuting the Christians, who's been putting them to death, and yet God chooses him. So the call, you're not the one that determines the call that you receive. Because the authority of the call or the message is in the sender. So when God calls us to go, our response, like Paul, I consider my life worth nothing if only to finish the race. Equate myself and make myself equal to the message. It will disable me in going forward with a mission. Because in that sense, I believe that I very well sent myself. Meaning that the value of this message is, how do I explain it? There's a sense of pride when you equate yourself equal to the message. Because you're saying, who sent me, I might have as well sent myself. I could have made this opportunity for myself. And so there's the hidden things to battle our minds when we accept the call. And I share this because, yes, I'm embarking on a journey. Yes, when you say yes, you allow the yes to keep unfolding the next step. We don't know the full picture. I don't know the full picture. Pastor Nadia, did you know the full picture when you went to Montreal? You don't know everything that you will encounter. You don't know all the people that you will encounter. But your yes has got to be tied to a greater commitment, which is, God, I say yes to you. It was not just a whim, but I answered a greater call. And because of that commitment, I'm staying the course. Along the way, your yes unfolds, brings forth every other instruction that needs to come forth. Just like the widow of Zarephath. I have instructed the widow to feed you, Elijah. But when you show up there, it's almost like she's not expecting you. But it was because her first yes needed to give way to her second yes and to give courage for her to keep on going. And that's how God builds us up. That's how God builds up our faith. And so that's all I have to share with us this afternoon. 2 minutes after. And with that, I want to welcome the worship team back. This song that we sang, In Christ Alone. Just so that we can worship, because it takes the focus off of us, the messenger. All of us here have a call. All of us here have received a promise. All of us here have got the things that we contend with. But our help is in the name of the Lord. And knowing that as we carry a message, who has sent us has everything. As it says in the book of Peter, that his divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us.
My hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm from the fiercest drought and storm.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Before we get into the ministry, as you are preaching, Bethia, the Spirit of God spoke to me, and this is a word for you. I feel like God is saying that he's sending you into the wilderness. The same way the Holy Spirit thrusted Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, and he came out full of power, ready to do ministry. I feel it's the same thing, that God is just thrusting you into the wilderness, not to be tempted by the devil, but to struggle to find your full potential. That God is bringing you to a place of where you're going to feel lonely, spiritually speaking. But it's going to be a time and a place where you and God will, like Jacob was, you know, what's the word? Wrestling with God. And God gave him a new name into Israel. That God is sending you to a place of wilderness. Not a wilderness to be tempted, but a wilderness where you're going to wrestle with God. Wrestle with your destiny. Wrestle. And so that God can give you what he has called you to do, so that when you come out, you're going to be a powerful minister of the gospel. Come out with a new name. This is so powerful. As I was sitting there and the Spirit of God was speaking to me, this is a good season for you. And sometimes he takes you away out of comfort, out of everything you have known. This is not about a job. Nova Scotia is not a place where you're going to just find a job, but it's a place where you're going to find the fullness of your calling and the expression of what God placed inside of you. So it's not going to be easy and fun, but it's going to be life-giving. You're going to find power. You're going to find the fulfillment of that which you have always believed. Amen. And we're going to see a different woman when she comes back. You're going to be a mighty, mighty minister of the gospel. This is too small for you. Hallelujah. Leading worship is not all that God has for you. So we thank God for this woman. I'm going to pray for her. And then she's going to minister to us. Hallelujah. I want you to come on your knees, because that's what God did for me in Montreal. Hallelujah. Can you stretch your hands towards this mighty woman? Oh, Father God, we give you praise. Rebaba sanda karabash tukurubosi. Remamandoko roboshe tekerepa. Remandoko robose tekere mandoko robos. The spirit that raised Christ from the dead is within you. Remandoko robose tekereba. That which has been confined in you, God said, is about to break it forth. You will contend with God, but you will find your purpose. You will find your fulfillment. For in time of hardship, of questioning, you will find yourself through these moments. Father God, I pray for the grace. Father God, let the battle begin. The fight for destiny. The fight for full expression, mighty God. We thank you, God, that the same way you gave a new name, Father God, to Jacob, you give a new name to this woman, Father God. God, that she will not be defined anymore, Father God. She'll come out as full of power, mighty God. to bring and deliver your word of truth, Father God, to the nations of the earth. We give you praise. We give you praise. I pray for the grace upon her life, Father God, that as she goes, Father God, that she is changing. In her going, she is changing already, Father God. In her saying yes, mighty God, she's already transformed, mighty God. In letting go of the comfort things, Father God, she's already transformed and empowered, Father God, to walk into her destiny, mighty God. So we thank you for the seasons of wilderness. We thank you for the season of transformation. We thank you for the season of the dark room, mighty God. We thank you for the season, because power will be expressed. Power will come out of this. Father God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Father God. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. This woman, we thank you, Father God, for who she's been in this season in CrossPointe. We thank you for what you're thrusting her by the Spirit of God, mighty God. Thank you, Father God, for her humility. We thank you, Father God, for power of transformation in her life. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the call, mighty God. We thank you for the price of the call, mighty God. Haya Baba, Sutu Kurubosh. The call of God is not convenient. It's not convenient. It's not convenient. Father God, we give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. Remandu kuru mondo koro boshe neke remanda. Remanda karaba shotoko. Rebaba sendeke. Remando koro boshe teke. Remamando koro boshe neke. Remando koro boshe neke. Rebaba sondo koro boshe neke. Remamando koro boshe neke. Remamande kereba. God said that in this place, CrossPointe, you have learned brokenness, you have learned faithfulness, you have learned servanthood, but where are you going? You're going to have to learn empowerment, empowerment, that God wants to empower you. Now is the season of empowerment in the mighty name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. I know a word for you. When I heard that you were going to Nova Scotia last weekend, I was driving with my hot wife in the back. And I told my wife, this woman has really blessed me. You know, we came to this church together, same year. It's been 11 years. And I said, God, I need to give her a word. But your word did not come from me. Your word came from Nicaragua, from Elizabeth Cano. And she said, it's in Psalm 40. I thought it was my word, but it's your word. He lifted me up out of a slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock, and he gave me a firm place to stand. To that. Whenever you fall, this is your scripture. Go on your knees and tell God, you gave me a firm place to stand. Therefore, I am built to last. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Is the offering ready? We're going to present her the offering and she's going to minister to us. Bethia, I'm so proud of you, of who the woman you have become. Hallelujah. God bless you. Hallelujah. When you told me you were leaving months ago, I thought, I always wait, but God spoke to me. It wasn't meant to be done in this house. And it's because of the price of the call. I wish you well. You have what it takes, Bethia. Extremely costly, Bethia. But it's worth it. And whenever you're going to go through dark times, tough times, just remember, If Pastor Nader did it, you can do it. And I know you will do it and do it well. You have overcome the greatest test I'm talking about. And that was a defining moment for you. But now where are you going? It will be greater for you. Just keep pushing. We are cheering for you. This whole house is cheering for you. And when you come back to minister, I know it's going to be glorious. And whenever you're tired, just come. And if you don't have money for the ticket, you need to call. Because now it's not Edmonton anymore. One of us in this house will pay for it. Amen? You come, you rest. But I know it's going to be glorious. And we're expecting great things from God for you. I'm going to ask Samuel to come here. Double, yes. Hallelujah. And our love for you. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, CrossPointe. Apostle had shared with us that his message was, it's not over yet. And so I want to take an opportunity to pray with anyone who has reached that point where you're sensing you're at your wit's end. And even to believe that statement is hard, because everything has been working against you, or you feel frustrated that it's not over yet, but somehow I'm wrestling to enter into this, to capture it in my mind, or even to believe that you really have something for me. If there's anyone like that here, I'd like to pray with you. Because as Pastor Nadia shared, that he that has begun the good work, he'll finish it, because he's faithful. He's faithful. He never starts something that he does not heart. And so if there's anyone that is wrestling with that, you can come and pray. Or I'm just going to lift up a voice and we can pray. And then afterward, the worship team, Jada, is going to lead us right back into that song. And so if you're here, feel free to make your way to the front. But I'm just going to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lift up each and every soul, each and every person that is anyone that has reached the place of discouragement and they're not sure where they're going forward to. Father, I pray that even in this moment, that faith would arise, that hope would arise, that yet the greater things are yet to come. That whatever God you have purposed and planned for them, and you're still doing what you have said you will do for such a time as this you have called us. So God, we declare that our ladder will be greater than the past. We declare that the ladder will be greater, that our tomorrows are better than the yesterdays that we have experienced. Father, I give you praise for each and every one in this house. Anyone that is in that place of wrestling, King of Glory, let strength rise. Let faith arise. Let hope arise in the name of Jesus. Father, we worship and exalt you. Let your name be praised, be hallowed in this place. Your name be lifted high. We worship you, adore you in Jesus' name. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This
cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trials and storm.
What heights of love, what depths of
sees,
my comforter. stand there in the ground, his body lay, light the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since his grip on me, for I am his and he is mine.
Drop of the precious
blood of Christ, no guilt in life.
Let's sing together.
No fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath,
Jesus commands my destiny.
No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ.
If you are here and you need personal ministry, I invite you to come in front. If not, let just worship the King of Kings. Hallelujah.
Can you put me in B, please?
Miracle worker. You are a miracle worker. Come and do a miracle today. Come and do a miracle today. Sing miracle worker, you are a miracle worker. A miracle today. Come and do a miracle. Call him destiny changer, destiny changer. Yeah, you are a destiny changer. Come and change, come and change a destiny today. Come and change destiny,
a destiny today.
Destiny changer, you are a destiny changer. Come and change, come and change a destiny today.
Come and change
a destiny today. Your name is Yah.
Destiny changer, come and change a destiny today. Come and change a destiny today. Again, destiny changer, destiny changer, hallelujah. Destiny changer, come and change destiny. A destiny today. Come and change a destiny today. Destiny changer. One more time, you got destiny changer. Come and change my destiny today. Come and change a destiny. A our destiny today. Your name is Yahweh. Your name is Yahweh. You are a miracle working God. Your name is Yahweh. Your name
is Yahweh. Your name is Yahweh. You are a miracle working God.
Your name again. Your name is Yahweh. Your name. Has found me just as I am, empty-handed, but alive in your hands. Majesty, oh, majesty, forever, forever. I am changed by your love. Hallelujah. In the presence of your majesty, majesty, majesty. Oh Lord, oh Lord, majesty forever, forever. Changed by your love and the presence of my majesty, majesty, oh, majesty, empty-handed, empty-handed, but alive in your hand.